Welcome to this video on the physical basis of the philosophical aspects of this video series on our successful future, which deals with different aspects that are required to reach sustainable goals with well-being for everybody. This video is actually the first video on these philosophical aspects, and before I start really to discuss philosophy, I would like to talk a little bit about the physical basis. And the very first starting point will be the molecular level, because that is a level on which I myself did research on and realized certain things that form, so to speak, a very basis of then the following philosophical considerations. Just to mention one aspect, of course, to give you an idea where we want to go, the point is that apparently we believe that we have the freedom of will, the freedom of choice. So we can choose this or that between different options. And that requires actually that there is some random aspect to that. So until we decide, we don't know how we will decide. We are really free to choose. That implies a certain aspect of randomness. Where is that coming from on the one hand side? And why is it in the end our personality that controls that? How is that interrelated? Because we believe also it's not just random how we decide, it's us who decide. But there has to be something random in it. How does that interplay relate with each other? And that's what I want to work out in the first 2-3 videos, so to speak. The first one starts with the molecular basis, the physical basis. If you are not so much into physics, possibly you just sit back and listen if you can grasp this or that aspect. I hope that I nevertheless express the things clearly, even if you are not a physicist. Yeah, I try to set up things and explain them such that in principle you should possibly be able to understand, I hope at least to a certain degree. Okay, what are the questions that I want to specifically answer? How do small perturbations influence molecular motion? There we see we are going really to molecules. I will show you how that works out in just a second. How do the molecules interact over large distances? What are the consequences for our worldview? And that's getting really interesting into philosophy. How does this influence the understanding of the arrow of time? That's an add-on question that I want to answer, especially because some longer time ago, that question has been made prominent more or less by Stephen Hawking, who wrote this short history of time. There that is mentioned, and because possibly many of you are aware of that question, several are aware of that question, I want to answer that or give one aspect to the answer as well. These things, the first things especially, have already been published in a scientific journal. You'll find it here. If you are interested in more technical details, they are explained in this publication. Now let's start. How do molecules behave? And as an example, I want to show you a small cluster of around 1,000 water molecules. They have been simulated on the computer. The individual water molecules, you see the oxygen in red and two hydrogen atoms that are linked to form this water molecule, H2O, and you see how they are wiggling around. Of course, it's significantly slowed down. Yeah, so it's a slow-mo of really water behavior. Actually, they are wiggling and moving around faster than the speed of sound. You see it's very much slowed down. And you see actually how they are wiggling around. They are rigid molecules, so the intermolecular force field assumes a rigid water molecule, and the Newton's laws of motion are solved in order to describe that behavior. I should also say that I'm using so-called periodic boundary conditions, that is, this small cube of water molecules is linked to itself, so the front is linked to its rear. And that way I mimic, so to speak, an infinitely extended system. It's the case in all directions, but that's actually where sometimes water molecules here appear and disappear again, because then they are moving to the rear and coming back again from the rear. That's why they are appearing and disappearing. So by solving Newton's law of motion, taking into account the exact laws that describe the interactions between the molecules, allows to determine the so-called trajectories, the paths of the different molecules. So where do they move as a function of time? That can be solved. Also, the wiggling around, the rotations, all that can be taken into account. How does that look like? Well, we see that we can follow that, these trajectories, but the first question that I wanted to answer or ask and then answer is, of course, how do small perturbations influence the motion of the molecules? Why that will become important, we will see at a later stage. So we first want to ask the question and answer it, how do small perturbations shift that? In order to figure that out, I took one water molecule, one arbitrarily selected, and at a certain point in time in that simulation, I shifted it a tiny little bit and then observed how does that simulation behave, how does that develop, and compare that with the simulation with the unshifted water molecule. So you get more or less the pathways, the trajectories of an unshifted molecule and that of tiny with a tiny shift. Shifted at one point in time by a very, very small amount. More or less going down to machine precision, to computer precision. So very, very small amounts. 10 to minus 8 or so, 10 to minus 10, as compared to the molecular dimensions, more or less, and less. Now, how does that look like? These are the trajectories. Of course, it's only a two-dimensional projection of the pathways. You see the start for all, it's actually three simulations, one unshifted, two slightly shifted by different amounts. The molecule moves around, and well, after some time, you see actually all the three pathways are on top of each other. But here you see that now the blue and the red start to diverge. The blue one moves like that, and the red one continues like this way. Then here you start to see already that the green one then starts to deviate from the red one. So another shift, so there are three shifts, the red one unperturbed, tiny little shift gives them the green curve, and a tiny little bit larger shift gives a blue curve. And there you see that they deviate after some time. But first of all, you don't see any deviation. Within the drawing accuracy, so the thickness of the line, they are flying on top of each other, the trajectories are lying on top of each other, and only after some time it becomes so big, the deviation, that actually becomes visible, that there's a visible divergence between the blue, the red, and the green and the red trajectories. Now one can, of course, evaluate the difference between the positions as a function of time quantitatively. So at every time, moment in time where this particle flies, I can ask, well, what's the difference between the red, the blue, and the green curves? As I said, they are induced here. The shifts are already induced here. And they grow. They grow until they become visible here or there. Now, how fast do they grow? And in order to quantify that, I evaluated that shift and plotted it versus time. That's shown here. Here we see the shifts with a certain starting shift at time zero as a function of time, how that increases. I start with different initial shifts, 10 to minus 8 nanometers, 10 to minus 10. I should say a nanometer is roughly molecular scale, so 1 nanometer is molecular scale. This is a millionth part, this is the millionth of the millionth part, 10 to minus 6, 10 to minus 12. Of such molecular scale, so it's extremely small shifts at which I start here. And then we see how that behavior develops as a function of time in picoseconds again. Picoseconds is a millionth part of a second, so extremely short times that we observe the system and we see how it increases it. In this scaling, it is a more or less linear increase, and we see that the different starting shifts lead to quite similar behavior. And that's already a quite strong statement, because the first question you have to answer is, well, is this observation that I have, is that a question of the algorithm that I use? So it's an artifact of the algorithm, or is it something of the behavior of the real behavior of the system? If it were, for example, since this is an integration of the Newton's law of motion, is that time step that I use for that integration, is that influencing the system, for example? If that were so, you would expect that if you go to larger initial perturbations, then you would see a change in behavior, because this small time step will cause more problems, so to speak, on a lower starting shift. Also, one can vary some major parameters defining this algorithmic part. It is, for example, take a shorter time step, use larger systems or other things. And one always observes, as for example with this blue curve, that the behavior is quite similar. The slope of this increase is quite similar. I should also say that, of course, there's this up and down, so very strong fluctuations of this behavior. But that is due to regarding only a single molecule. Of course, that's wiggling around and there's a certain random aspect with that, and that leads to this up and down that you have. Overall, the behavior behaves more or less like this red dotted line. And this is more or less a linear behavior as a function of time. Now, linear with this logarithmic scaling, if you know that, if you're an engineer or a scientist or so, you directly realize this is logarithmic scaling. But such a linear straight line in this with that logarithmic scaling means the initial perturbation is increasing exponentially. So any initial shift will increase exponentially. And the time scale that characterizes that is 0.3 picoseconds. Expressed this way, it means that every 0.23 picoseconds, so every quarter of a millionth of a second roughly, the perturbation or the shift in the molecule will increase by a factor of 10, which is quite dramatic. So this is the so-called Lyapunov instability, and this exponential increase is also the basis to call it deterministic chaos. Well, why is it deterministic? It's deterministic because the equations describing the system, they are exactly defined. We have Newton's law of motion. We have the potential functions, so the interaction forces between the water molecules, exactly defined with defined values of all the parameters. So it's an exactly defined system. So in principle, if we define the starting conditions of the system, the positions and the velocities of the molecules with arbitrary accuracy, we are able to predict the behavior over an extended period of time, more or less up to into an arbitrary future, in principle, of course. Since we have limited accuracy of our computers, which correspond to something down here, we will introduce always some perturbations are arbitrary into the system that will then increase quite rapidly, which can be discussed, which also leads to some insights into such simulations as is worked out in the paper that I mentioned at the beginning. Okay, so what do we learn from that? We learn first of all that this increases exponentially in this so-called deterministic chaos. Now, what does that teach us? Well, if we look now at the behavior of the system and we want to describe, so to speak, the behavior beyond a certain accuracy. If we say, for example, we want to describe this molecular path with an accuracy of 10 to minus 4 nanometers, so somewhere here, then this equation tells us that for every 0.23 picoseconds further into the future, we have to increase the starting accuracy, the accuracy of the starting coordinates, by a factor of 10. This is what this equation tells us. And we can also see it, so to speak, if we want to go from here to, say, here. No, actually here. One more picosecond into the future. We have to go down 4 more decades of accuracy. That's what this tells, more or less. So if we want to have a certain prediction accuracy over a certain period of time, the farther we go into the future, every 0.23 picoseconds exactly, to be exact, more into the future, we need to increase the precision of our starting coordinates by a factor of 10. That's, of course, dramatic, because 0.23 picoseconds is not so much. So if you want to predict the system over some realistic macroscopic time, you can forget that, because you don't have computer power to do that. Now we can collect the information, so to speak, collect the consequences. We have seen that the system of molecular motion occurs according to deterministic chaos, which defines the Lyapunov instability, which in turn is related to the Lyapunov time. The Lyapunov time, I should say, is that time where how that grows, so to speak, by a factor of e being the basis of the natural logarithm, so 2.7 something. This Lyapunov time is roughly 0.1 picoseconds, but I prefer actually to express it, this increase by one decimal digit, by a factor of 10, and that is then proportional to that, it's 0.23 picoseconds. Then what we just saw, prediction every 0.23 picoseconds further into the future requires one more decimal digit in the start coordinates and in the calculations. So not just in the beginning, but all your calculations have to be performed at that higher accuracy. And thus, the system cannot be predicted over some intermediate times. This statement is only about prediction. We want to predict it, and it tells us that if we want to have a prediction over some extended period of time, we need more and more accuracy. That's what it says. It's about prediction. It's nothing about reality itself. Yeah, if you ask deterministic chaos, well, what is chaotic? Well, it's determined. Everything is determined. Why is it chaotic? I don't understand, more or less. And that was a question, actually, that I was having since many decades, and since I was a youngster, so to speak, when I read my first books about deterministic chaos, that was already bothering me. Now I would point out one thing here with this higher accuracy of the starting conditions. I would fix that or give an example for that, that we will then regard later, because we will see that it's much worse in the following considerations. If we take, for example, the case that you want to predict the system behavior over, say, 33 picoseconds, arbitrarily at the moment, but we will see later why that number is important. If you want to predict it over 33 picoseconds, we need a certain number of decimal digits to describe it with a certain accuracy. And the number of digits is somewhere of the order of 140. So we need a little bit more, actually, than 140 decimal digits to perform a prediction of the system over 33 picoseconds up to, say, molecular accuracy, so that the molecule is more or less within its range where it should be, more or less. That is simply obtained by dividing the 33 picoseconds by the 0.23 picoseconds. That tells us how many digits we need, more or less. So 140, a little bit more than 140 digits to describe this system over 33 picoseconds. It can be done for a small number of water molecules. That's possible. There are computer algorithms that allow you to extend the accuracy of the computer. Typically, you have only 16 or so decimal digits, or even only 8. But you can increase that. There are tools to do so. 140 is already a challenge. Of course, if you want to do the description over extended periods of time, it's getting worse and worse, as we just discussed. But now let's take a different look. I asked myself, what can we do about that? And in doing so, I came up with a certain perspective. So let's assume that our water system that we have described so far is this water glass. So we know how to describe the molecules in that water. They behave according to this deterministic chaos. And then we look how one water molecule is now interacting with another water molecule somewhere else. They are, of course, interacting. For simplicity, we will later assume that it's gravity that leads to that interaction. So they are gravitationally interacting. That force is extremely small. Of course, if that molecule is here and this molecule is in the water glass that we observe, so this is our observed water molecule, this is the distant water molecule. Now, so the observed water molecule will be shifted by a very small amount by this interaction with this distant water molecule. Very small shift. Of course, we know that shift will increase according to the Lyapunov time by a factor of 10 every 0.23 picoseconds. We know that. Yeah, now the question is actually, if that particle, this water molecule, this distant water molecule, is moving farther and farther away, so the shift that that distant molecule induces in the observed molecule is getting less and less. But nevertheless, this shift increasing exponentially, the question is, which effect will win? That with increasing distance, the initial shift gets smaller, or that the Lyapunov time leads to an increased shift at this water molecule? Which effect wins? Okay, that's one thing. That's the answer. That's the question that I want to answer. Before I want to do that, I want to introduce a concept of bifurcation and also a little bit of deterministic system. In order to observe that, I want to refer to something which you possibly know from your physics classes at school. This is the ideal pendulum that is typically used in physics classes to get some access of the conservation of energy, where the potential energy and the kinetic energy are interchanged, so to speak. That then leads to the description of the behavior of the pendulum, a deterministic description of the pendulum. How is such an ideal pendulum realized? Well, on the one hand side, you have some frictionless point of rotation. To that is connected a massless rod, and at the end of the massless rod, you have a point mass where this entire system has no air resistance. And if you take now, where this is a fixed point, but it can freely, the rod can rotate frictionless around that. If you now take the mass, put it to a certain point and release it, then the behavior is more or less the pendulum moving back and forth. And you can describe that with the sine function quite accurately. You can be more accurate because the height with respect to the center of Earth is changing slightly, so you have a slight variation in the gravitational force that you can account for as well, and then you can describe that more or less into an arbitrary future, at least under these idealized conditions. So this is a determined system, a deterministic system. You start, you define your starting conditions, and then it continues just forever, more or less, and you can describe it. But there is one exceptional point. This point is this shown here. So this is still our point of rotation, frictionless, the rod, massless, and then we have our mass up here, and we place that mass now exactly above that point of rotation. At that point, the mass has two options. It can move left or right. Where will it go? Of course, we can try to put it exactly on top of this point of rotation. And it's really a frictionless point of motion, of rotation. Then, of course, it's important if I'm standing on this side, because then I will attract this mass by my gravitation. I'm exerting a gravitational force on that mass. I will pull it in this direction, so it will start this way. If I stand on the other side, it will move the opposite direction. Now, of course, you can go ahead and try to account for that, to compensate. So if I'm standing here, you put it a tiny little bit more to the left, not as much as I showed, just a tiny little bit, so that my gravitation is just compensated. But then you realize, actually, it matters if somebody in the audience, there's no audience at the moment, but somebody, if there were an audience, if there in that audience some person is scratching his nose. Now, that would then be important. And that would then exert some force on this, some shift in gravitation that will then lead to one or the other option to be realized. And actually that example is nicely presented on a YouTube video by Hans-Peter Dürr. Actually, Das Pendel, it's in German, but he very nicely explains that, and he then says, well, at that point, apparently, the system is infinitely sensitive. At that so-called bifurcation, the system is infinitely sensitive to any changes in the environment. And he expresses it such that he says, if a photon is passing by from Andromeda galaxy, that will influence in the end, if you try to compensate everything else, that will then in the end lead to that pendulum starting its motion in this or the other direction. And this is a bifurcation. If you literally translate that, so to speak, a forking between two options. There are two options, and it forks, so to speak, into one of these options. That's why it's a bifurcation. Okay, so now knowing this, we can also realize that any initial shift of the molecules, in turn, also constitutes something like a bifurcation. Yeah? So if you have a small shift of the molecule position at the beginning, this is a similar diagram as before, but some more initial shifts shown. And also the molecules are observed over some extended period of time, so that the direction is more developed in different directions, apparently. This is somewhere the starting position, so all the trajectories are more or less on top of that at the beginning, but then they start to deviate. And you see actually that these small initial shifts that are introduced more or less randomize the behavior of the molecules after some time. So this is also some type of bifurcation. It's actually not a bifurcation, not just two options, but many options. That's why you can call that a multifurcation. So any shift in that behavior leads to a multifurcation. Any shift induced, of course, also by some distant water molecule. Any initial shift will lead to a multifurcation of the behavior. Now the question is, how does that relate with the distance of the interacting molecule? And for that, I would like to, after we have now explained what we understand by bifurcation, we want to look at that quantitatively. So the question we want to ask is, how long does it take until the interaction with that distant water molecule leads to an observable bifurcation, a bifurcation being defined as a shift by one molecular diameter? Now, why this shift by molecular diameter? So if you have this water molecule, that will of course be surrounded. We saw that in the movie at the beginning. That will be surrounded by some neighboring water molecules. And a shift by a molecular diameter means, so to speak, that that molecule decided if it wants to move left or right to one of its neighbors. So it passes left or right of one of the neighbors. That is that shift. And that's a bifurcation, apparently. So that characterizes the shift by one molecular diameter, characterizes a bifurcation. The interaction, as I mentioned already previously, we want to assume that that is gravitation. So we want to avoid quantum effects more or less. It's not possible in principle completely, but it gets close at least. So we have a gravitational interaction between the distant water molecule and that in the glass of water that we imagine to stand in, on the table directly in front of us. And there we observe that water molecule. And then we can, of course, evaluate that quantitatively. Now, I just want to mention these equations for the physicists among you. It's quite simple. It can be solved directly. We see the gravitational interaction. We see the Newton's law of motion. We see some definitions here of acceleration. We see our exponential increase of the shift with the starting shift and some time scale. The scaling time is 0.23 picoseconds in that case. Then you can plug everything into each other and then solve it for that reaction time that is required or that occurs, well, that has to pass until the bifurcation is reaching the size of one molecular diameter induced by the interaction with a distant molecule. I should say that one also has to account for the time of the interaction between the distant molecule and that nearby and that observed molecule in the glass of water. And there one has to say it's twice the Lyapunov time that is required as minimizing the overall time, namely the interaction time, as well as the reaction time. This is the reaction time, and then there is some time of interaction. If you want to minimize the sum of both, it's twice the Lyapunov time for that interaction that you account for. And that's used here, this simulation. The longer it interacts, the larger will be the shift, the faster everything goes, then after all, but only the reaction time. Now this reaction time until this bifurcation is reached is plotted as a function of the distance in meters of this distant water molecule with respect to the water molecule in the glass of water in front of us. We only need to take into account the red and the green curve here. This is the water molecule just interacting by gravitation. And that means, so to speak, if that water molecule is on the moon, so quite far away, then the bifurcation will occur after 15 picoseconds. 15 times 10 to minus 12 seconds. It's still extremely short time. Crazy that it's so fast, right? So after 15 picoseconds, the water molecule in our glass of water will react to the interaction, the gravitational interaction of a water molecule on the moon. But actually, wait a minute. In the glass of water, there are many water molecules that interact with that molecule on the moon. And of course, the interaction forces on all of these water molecules will be quite similar. So actually, they will move all to in a certain direction. And so the relative shift between the water molecules is much less. Yeah, they will both water molecule and the neighbors will all shift by almost the same amount. But there is a small difference in the forces that acts. And that can be taken into account here, that's then calculated here with the so-called delta gravitation. That's just the differential shift or the difference in the shift between neighboring molecules induced by the interaction with a distant water molecule. And there we see that the reaction time increases somewhat. Instead of the 15 picoseconds, it's then around 20 picoseconds if the water molecule is on the moon that interacts with the glass of water in front of us. We see that actually increases linearly in this logarithmic scale, and even if the water molecule, the far away, the distant molecule is at the end of the observable universe, the interaction leading to a bifurcation will occur after just 33 picoseconds. That means after 33 picoseconds, the bifurcation of the water molecule in the glass of water will be influenced by the molecule at the end of the observable universe. And I should say that's nothing about prediction, that's about the interaction as it occurs. It's not just predicting, it's really reality how that interaction occurs. At the same time, one has to say, of course, the interaction takes its time to get here. Yeah? Actually, from the end of the observable universe, it's defined such that that more or less corresponds to the Big Bang, so we can't look farther because we can't reach farther with the light, we can't see anything any farther. And that means the speed of light is just sufficient for that information to travel to us. And that's of course the speed at which also gravitation travels, has been debated, but finally the outcome is more or less that it, is more or less the speed of light with which a gravitation travels to us. So that is also the end of the observable universe, means it goes back more or less to the Big Bang, to the start of time, that that interaction now has reached us finally. Nevertheless, 33 picoseconds after the interaction reached us, it will lead to bifurcation. And actually, all molecules will lead to the same interaction, to the same effect. Now one can ask, of course, what does it mean? There are so many molecules around, or particles, one should generally say, because at the Big Bang there won't have been molecules, but particles will have been around. Doesn't that smear out? Doesn't that average out? No, this statement says it is not so, because we have to keep in mind that the forces acting on the water molecule we observe are just linearly superimposed. It's just this linear sum of all the interaction forces, which means actually that if I switch off that molecule at the end of the observable universe, that interaction will not contribute to the overall force that is experienced, and the effect will be exactly that we have discussed before, because it's just a linear superposition. Of course, it doesn't then correspond exactly to that motion, because all molecules are interacting, but the Lyapunov increase, that will occur exactly according to that interaction, that individual interaction. Now we can spell that out a little bit more in detail with this interaction time, the speed of light with which gravitation moves, so to speak. If we regard that as our distant particle, that as the water molecule in the glass in front of us on the table, for example, then of course this interaction will move as a function of time and finally will reach our water molecule that we observe. So at a certain point this starts with the interaction, then that moves on, so to speak, and it reaches that. So actually this water molecule reacts to that particle here, T4, this T means time, time 4, so that time before it reaches here. So actually the interaction has been induced by the molecule as it was in the past, T4, the time corresponding to T4 in the past, which is then reaching that water molecule. Now this is a spherical behavior, so the force or the information characterizing that gravitational interaction is traveling in all directions simultaneously. Those are spherical interactions that increase in as a function as the time proceeds. And we want to simplify that. We only want to look at the time and the x coordinate. We just forget these two other axes, they are there, but just let's focus on the x and the t. And if we now plot how from the distant particle, as a function of time, the distance where that interaction can be felt increases as a function of time. So at one point in time, that particle is there, emits at that point in time its interaction, so to speak, or what to sends out the information required about its interaction. That information on gravitation, for example, will travel at the speed of light, will eventually hit our water molecule, and then the water molecule reacts. 33 picoseconds later, that water molecule will be in a different place, at the latest. At the latest, especially that relates to the particles at the end of the observable universe, where this T0, where the interaction started, corresponds more or less to the Big Bang, plus minus a little bit, possibly. One should say that's, of course, only the extreme case. Particles that are closer by, as we have seen, that will lead to that bifurcation sooner, in shorter times than the 33 picoseconds. Okay, now collecting all that, we can express that a little bit more positively. We can say, because this way we are always looking into the past, now let's look into the future. All particles are continually sending information about themselves, their position, the mass, if it's relevant for gravitation, for example. That information travels in all directions at the speed of light. Then any particle, any of the other particles, or all particles, experience at every moment the sum of all interactions that are just arriving at that point in time where we observe that particle, so to speak. All these interactions with all particles will reach that observed particle. And then this particle will react to that interaction. But as I said, if you switch off one of the interactions, take away one of the particles, then the interaction will be different. And so if any faraway particle would have been in a slightly different place or not have been there, after at most 33 picoseconds, the observed particle, that in the glass of water we are looking at, would react differently at any of the multifocations, would move in a different direction. And that is so because the interactions superimpose linearly. That means, of course, that all the particles are constantly interacting on a very, well, crazy network of interactions. They're continually all interacting, back and forth, so to speak. Now, how does that really look like? If you want to work that out, I did a calculation on that. Of course, I wasn't able to do that big simulation with all the digits, so I collected that interaction force, so to speak, in a separate variable, which was extremely small, and that worked out. And then when it reached the size of the the numerical accuracy, then I added that, so to speak, in the direction, and then I was able to continue with the simulation as you see it here. And if you start at zero, of course, all the water molecules, same water molecules at the beginning in the video, are shown. This one is the same water molecule. It's also just water, but it's to identify this individual water molecule, it's colored in blue. So here at the start zero, it reacts, or the interaction of the distant molecule is arriving, and we observe on the one inside the isolated system, so no interaction, and then the system interacting with a single water molecule at the end of the observable universe. And we see at the start they are identical. After 31.9 picoseconds, they are still in the same place. Everything else around that is in the same way as well. After 32 picoseconds, so shortly before we reach this 33 picoseconds, we see already a slight shift in orientation, but the place is still the same, more or less. But then if we reach the 33 picoseconds, then the water molecule is obviously in a different place. It's always the same section drawn here, so there we see it's in a different position. Indeed, this shows that indeed that will add up to this Lyapunov increase, so that in 33 picoseconds the shift is more or less by one molecular diameter. Okay, so that cone of interaction, as I want to call it, it's actually called that way, reaches that particle and then that interacts within 33 picoseconds to that bifurcation. And as I said, this 33 picoseconds is only from the particle at the end of the observable universe. If it's closer by, it reacts faster. And so all interactions will finally lead to a bifurcation, will influence the bifurcation. But the closer the particles, the other interacting particles are, the faster that will have grown to that size. And all these tendencies, so to speak, will interact and will act on that observed molecule. What we have actually is a very fine microstructure of our force field, so to speak, and the particles will bifurcate according to this very fine microstructure of the force field. So all particles influence each other within 0 to 3 picoseconds, depending on the distance, on a universal scale, and I should also say it can possibly be much faster. Why can it be much faster? Well, I've done the simulation to obtain this Lyapunov time with rigid molecules, so no internal vibrations. And it is generally such that the more details on a smaller and faster time scale you take into account, the shorter the Lyapunov time becomes. So if you look at planets, how they move, then it will be decades and centuries, that Lyapunov time. For molecules, much smaller, it's just picoseconds. And if you now take into account the internal vibrations, which occurs on femtoseconds, so much smaller time scale and faster, then that will of course lead to faster Lyapunov times, or shorter Lyapunov times as well. So it's possibly much faster. So that's more or less some large level. It can be extremely much faster. But the interactions travel at the speed of light. And this is, I mentioned that already, is about the interaction of all the molecules in reality, not only about predicting something. This accounts for all the reactions as they occur, as they are. It's not just describing how badly we are able to describe that. It has a randomizing effect, and it applies in a fully deterministic worldview. So we don't need to take any quantum effects into account to have more or less this randomization. Well, what does it actually mean? Let's stay here for a moment. Because before I mentioned these 33 picoseconds, we need to describe the system according to deterministic chaos just for with an accuracy of 140 roughly decimal digits. Now it's actually worse. If you want to predict, do a prediction for 33 picoseconds, what does that mean? We need to take into account that interaction coming from the particle from the end of the observable universe, which just is reaching the particle as we start our simulation, because that will have grown to a bifurcation, to a molecular scale after these 33 picoseconds. And we saw that that interaction took its time from the Big Bang until it reached here. So actually, if you want to describe the 33 picoseconds of the water molecule, this observed water molecule, we actually need to take into account all interactions with all particles up to or all included in this observable universe. Every particle has to be included, and it has to be simulated. All the influences have to be taken into account since the Big Bang. So it's not just 140 decimal digits. It's taking into account everything. The entire universe, since it began, has to be taken into account if you do want to do a prediction over just 33 picoseconds. It's a completely different statement. Much more chaotic, much more random. Of course, also much more unpredictable. And randomness just meaning more or less we are absolutely not able, even some picoseconds, to follow the real path of a real molecule. It's just utterly impossible. With an arbitrary precision, it's impossible. So if we develop our computers further with arbitrary significant digits, it won't work out. We are not able to do that ever. That's what man can call, so to speak, random effect. At the same time, we have learned something about bifurcation. Namely, we saw, I didn't work that out in all detail, but one can work that out and show that any complex system, especially if there is some feedback of the interactions, that's what is required, that will show, such a system will show deterministic chaos. So you will have this randomization. You will have, on the other hand side, that at a bifurcation, the system is randomly influenced by all particles in the universe, or randomizingly influenced by all particles in the universe, at any bifurcation, any of these systems. This will become relevant if you talk about this random effect on free will. That will be what we will be talking about. Now, the next slides, I would like to take the opportunity and to relate that back to the arrow of time that has been discussed since several decades, actually, since a quite long time, but it became famous to a certain degree with this book, A Short History of Time, of Stephen Hawking. And, well, how is this reversal of time on the arrow of time, what does it describe? Actually, we realize, if we write down the physical laws, that we can solve them in a forward time direction, but we can also solve them the reverse. So nobody actually tells us that time should be running forward, or that our time is actually running forward. It could well be that it's running backward. And that becomes obvious if we talk about the conservation of energy and momentum. Yeah, if two of these billiard balls hit and then they move in a different direction, you can determine that by the conservation of energy and momentum. And of course, if you say, well, before the particles hit, they have the same energy as after, then you can say, well, after they have the same energy as before. So which way round you express that, it's the same statement. And it can be used either way round to solve how the particles move. So if you just would inverse all the motions of all particles at a certain point in time, of all of the particles, and exchange a charge, some boundary conditions for the physicist, then you would just inverse the behavior of the system. Same holds for the Newton's law of motion. And then one looks about the system and asks the question, well, how can we nevertheless decide that it is in forward or backward direction? And one example typically given is this so-called entropy, the thermodynamic direction of the arrow of time. Entropy describing the disorder of the system. Yeah, the larger the entropy, the larger the disorderliness of the system. And how can that be realized, or how can that be explained? If you look, for example, at the break shot of a billiard, a pool billiard table, where you first have your triangular arrangement of all the colored balls, and you have your white ball, and you hit it, and it hits the first time into this triangular arrangement. And you take a video of that, and you see all the particles moving in all billiard balls moving in all directions. And then you take the video and run it backward. then all the billiard balls will move backward until they finally wind up in this nice triangular shape, this nice triangular arrangement. And then you see, oh, that can't be, that's wrong. Because order increased, entropy decreased, and that can't be. So entropy reduction is improbable. Reversing that movie is improbable. Actually, it's not impossible, thermodynamically speaking, but it's improbable, arbitrarily improbable that that actually should really happen. So if you would, by random arrangement and random motion, would wait until particle or the billiard balls move backward and by themselves lead to that regular arrangement, you would need to wait forever, more or less. It will never happen. It's arbitrarily improbable. Of course, here it's nice to see that, but how about this system? We saw that already. Same interactions going on. Can you tell me if that's in forward or backward direction? No, you can't. So actually, this billiard ball argument only applies if you start out with some ordered structure, which then converts into disorder. If you are in a more or less irregular arrangement at the beginning, you can't say if it's forward or backward. It's impossible. Can we nevertheless get some idea about defining or realizing the direction of time somehow? And in order to do that, we look again at this diagram. We saw that before, this cone of interaction, how that develops from the particle, distant particle at the end of the observable universe, extending its cone of interaction, meeting somewhere that water molecule that we observe, and then we know 33 picoseconds later we have the bifurcation of this particle. And of course, we can inverse that. Sure, we can. Well, how does it work out? We start with a bifurcated molecule 33 picoseconds before. We can describe that by deterministic laws, possibly. Let's assume we can that. And then, of course, at that point, actually, we have to that has to have realized the interaction with that particle exactly at that moment in time is exactly the right force. And now all other particles that this interaction, this cone of interaction, so to speak, met as it expanded, they have to be folded back, so to speak, so as to have the interaction exactly at the time before, at a different position, and so on, until finally this cone of interaction, so to speak, merges into a single point, and at that point you have then exactly that particle. That means if you want to inverse that effect of this cone of interaction, it has to shrink until it becomes collapses at that point of the where the particle is at, in this case at the Big Bang at that position. So one can now say in forward direction this particle will just expand, will send out its information, it will reach somewhere and everything is fine. But in reverse, all these influences of this interaction, so to speak, have to fold backward such that in the end all these interactions lead to that single point where that particle actually then has to be exactly at that point in time when that collapses to that single point. And of course now this applies, this necessity to be able to fold that backward to that single particle here means if you want to inverse time, that has to be realized by all the particles that all these interactions in this universal network ever met anywhere during their lifetime. Which means if you want to run it backward, it only works if the system has before developed in a forward direction, and then you stop and then you reverse everything. Then you can fold it backward and since it's deterministic until now, that's the assumption that we made, then everything will properly fall backward and everything is fine. But if you would start with an arbitrary random position of all particles, but possibly not random, that doesn't work because you have to fulfill all these conditions of these cones of interaction all folding back until they meet, they collapse at a point, and there has to be a particle that in the forward direction would have emitted that interaction. This folding backward, so to speak, poses an infinite number, more or less infinite number, of conditions on how you can place and arrange your particles at your start when you want to reverse the time. So we can collect that, so to speak, The physical laws themselves, they may very well be time reversible. That holds for most of the laws. There's one elementary particle where that is debated, but who knows how that will turn out. If you look in forward direction, then the initial conditions can freely be chosen and only in forward direction. In backward direction, you have a vast multitude, an infinite multitude of conditions that correspond from the necessity to fold backward all these cones of interactions to points until they reach collapse to a point where then that particle has to be at that point in time, which in fact means reversal is only possible starting from a system that developed in a forward direction first. And so it's only possible to reverse time if you started out the forward way and then at a certain point stop and then return. And then of course the question, well, that's quite artificial. Why doesn't it develop in the forward direction in the first place? So backward direction is impossible because it's impossible to define the starting conditions independent of any other condition. You can't define the starting conditions. So it's not a question of the physical laws. It's a question of the definition of the starting or these so-called initial conditions. But of course, one has to keep one thing in mind. Ernst Mach, wise guy, physicist and philosopher, said there is no cause nor effect in nature. Nature has but an individual existence. Nature simply is. This relates, of course, to cause and effect, but what he says more or less means our description of the behavior of the system, here relating to cause and effect, but also all other physical laws, that's our perspective on the things, our description. And if we ask the question if the time is in forward or backward time, nature doesn't care. Nature simply is. Yeah, only in our physical laws that we apply, we have the ability to run it forward or backward. But it's not that how. That's not how nature is. Nature just develops somehow. Nature simply is. It actually goes further because it assumes that all time is more or less in that system is just one variable. If time proceeds in the deterministic system, everything is given more or less, and that overall time development is also at a, well, it's not as a function of time, it's just there, so to speak. Okay, but that's a higher degree of complexity. Anyway, we need to realize that the question of time forward or backward is only about our description of reality, and nature actually doesn't care so much about that. Okay, with that I have laid the basis, so to speak, then in the next video to talk about the different levels, one of these levels being the molecular level, and then we build on that until we go to systems where we can hopefully realize something that resembles somehow our personality, our structure, as we will see, that then somehow, somehow limits the possibilities of this randomness, somehow tames the randomness that we have on the lower level, so that we have a free will being really related, not just random, but corresponding to our individual personality. But that's the next video. So thanks for today for watching this video on physical basis of the philosophical aspects, and I would be happy if you join me in one of the next videos.